Good afternoon. Thank you for joining this webcast. My name is Michael Kaska. I'm a member of the McDonnell Hopkins Business Restructuring Services Department. Today is a special webcast for accountants. It is challenges in the oil and gas industry. Because we have a lot of information to cover today, I'm going to make the introductions brief. I'd like to introduce the colleagues that are joining this panel. Next to me is Jeff Huntsberger, who's a member of our Energy Practice Group. And next to him is Judd Schief, who is a member of the firm's Commercial Litigation Practice Group with an emphasis on oil and gas. And then at the end of the table is Steve Gross, who's the chair of the Business Restructuring Services Department. Jeff and I are based here in Cleveland. Judd is in our Columbus office, and Steve is in the firm's Detroit office. Well, a year ago today, gas or oil prices were over $100 per barrel. A lot's happened in the last year, and maybe we could start by describing some of those things that have gone on to bring gas price or oil prices down where they are today.
Sure. Well, basic economics, the supply has just really skyrocketed. And think about it this way. The Saudis and OPEC for a long, long time really controlled what the price of oil was. When the shale boom began to develop in the United States, it was fairly gradual to begin with and grew larger and larger to what it is today, with a prospect to grow even substantially larger. And the question became really, would the Saudis, would they reduce their production? And if not, we would end up with substantially more oil on the market. And what's that going to do? Basic economics, again, it's going to reduce the price, the value of that oil. So the Saudis, I think, surprised a lot of people by not reducing it. That's had a very large negative impact on countries like Venezuela and Russia and Nigeria. And it's had a somewhat of a negative impact, too, on U.S. shale production, but we'll talk more about that. So the simple answer is that things, there's just so much more out there in the market, and it's gotten a whole lot cheaper for that reason.
And what other, I mean, OPEC recently had a meeting, again, after their November meeting. They had one recently, and it does not appear they're going to do anything about production. Are there any geopolitical issues that we foresee impacting oil and gas in the near term?
Yeah. Well, it's really going to depend upon what's going on with OPEC long term. But Iran, for example, is a huge piece of all this. If things are worked out from the nuclear standpoint with Iran, and Iran is able to put its oil on the market again, that will further deplete prices. What I think you'll see among U.S. shale producers and what they've shown to this point is kind of an uncanny ability to be more and more efficient and to produce this product at a lower price. So what will be really important, I think, internationally will be who can produce it most cheaply. There's no way that anybody is going to produce it much more cheaply than the Saudis and certain other Arab countries can in that area. But, you know, who can produce it secondly most cheaply? And what we found is that whereas Saudi Arabia used to be the main swing state, you know, the state that could adjust most quickly to the need out there, the U.S. market has really begun to fill that as well. U.S. oil and gas producers have been able, through their free market system, through what we have here in the United States, they've been able to kind of turn on and turn off this as appropriate, and it has forced them, and they've become far more efficient than they had been initially. You know, it used to take them really twice as long to drill a well. Used to take them 40% more in cost to drill a well, and it's just become much more efficient for them today.
And I would add to that, Jeff, that I just read that the current administration is considering enacting additional environmental regulations by executive order. We don't know what the scope of those regulations are or will be or the impact that they will have, but it certainly provides a little bit of uncertainty as to even what the next year or so is going to look like.
Right.
Well, one of the issues that I think was in the Saudis' minds is that, you know, there's a pretty steep demand curve when they're producing, or production decline curve when they're producing these wells for the shale producers. So what's the impact here, you know, in Ohio, on in the Utica region, on, you know, are we going to need to drill a bunch of, keep drilling a bunch of holes everywhere to continue production, or are we going to be able to turn on and off the spigot, for lack of a better term, to, you know, allow us some flexibility in terms of, you know, waiting for commodity prices to rise at appropriate levels? Yeah.
Well, I think it is true that these wells, the shale wells, tend to fall off perhaps a little bit more quickly than the more traditional wells would have. But even after they fall off, they will continue and have shown that they'll continue to produce for very extended periods of time. What could happen is that enough of the E&P exploration production companies could decide to really pull back in their drilling, which is beginning to happen now, that you get to the point where those, where you don't have wells which are replacing that high production per well. And given that, U.S. production could begin to fall off. We're just now, for the first time, beginning to see some hints that U.S. production will fall off. To this point, at least, you know, we, for example, we've had 1,600 rigs out there in shale plays around the country. That's now down to 640 rigs, so a pretty dramatic reduction. But production of oil has gone from 9.1 million barrels per day to 9.6 million barrels per day, even with this drastically reduced rig count. But in terms of overall pricing, if not enough new wells are produced, and the perception, because perception of pricing is really most important, but if the perception is that we may be ending up with just a little bit of a shortage, doesn't take much, but just a little bit of a shortage, suddenly at that point you'll see prices go up pretty dramatically. And that certainly has been the history, Judd, I think you would agree, of the oil and gas business, is that you can't rely on regular pricing. You're going to have boom and you're going to have bust. And that may be even a little bit more likelier now that the Saudis don't seem to be quite as willing to keep that price set at the same level that they had before.
No, I think that's absolutely right. I think especially with the public companies that are involved in developing the shale play, there's an inherent tension there that's at play back and forth, shareholders demanding a return on the investment that they've made in acquiring all of these leasehold interests in the infrastructure to deliver the hydrocarbons, but at the same time, the price of oil and gas being where it is might not be as economical to recover, and you're seeing some wells perhaps shut in or drilling slowed down to let prices catch up to where shareholders expect their profits to be.
Right. And one thing to remember, too, of course, is that when you've actually drilled this well and you're producing, you can produce that at a very cheap price. The question is, how many new wells will you drill? There are at least three or four different big E&P companies that have pretty much pulled out of production at this point. But there are other companies, Gulfport happens to be one, this has been in the news, that has spent about $400 million on new leasehold rights, mm-hmm. and they plan to keep moving. So I think it's a chance for the stronger companies to acquire some rights from some of the companies that aren't quite as strong. And that's certainly one of the things we're going to talk about today is, you know, what's the impact of everything that's going on here with some of the companies that potentially could be struggling more.
So, you know, we're talking about shale plays around the United States, you know, yep. Texas, North Dakota, Oklahoma, Louisiana, Pennsylvania, Ohio. At the beginning of this, sort of the shale boom in Ohio, everyone thought that this was going to be more of an oil play. It's actually proven to be more of a natural gas and natural gas liquids play. So what has happened within the local or Ohio region that you know, how has the thought shifted and the processes shifted?
I think two things, Mike. The first is development of gas rather than oil and the costs associated with the processing of the gas and the delivery of the gas through the systems, and it not being the oil play that they necessarily expected. I also think that they found out geographically that the play, they're focusing in more and more on where these minerals are in a producible quantity. So I think you're seeing a shift more from northeastern Ohio down to central Ohio and southeast Ohio that's proven, for example, in the Monroe County area to be the most profitable area for producing these minerals. So in the state of Ohio, those are the two consequences. I think we're seeing a less of a concentration up here in northeastern Ohio, more in central and southeastern Ohio, and the distinction in costs between developing oil resources and gas resources.
And certainly gas price has gone down as well. They really are kind of independent. It's important to think about them as really two separate markets too, because with oil, you can export oil, right? You put it in a tanker, you put it in a ship, and you can export it. That's becoming true of natural gas as well, but it's not, to this point, there haven't been the facilities developed. And so oil will tend to have more of an international price, and natural gas will tend to have more of a national or even local price. With all the gas that's being produced in the Utica and the Marcellus, you know, we're finding that natural gas prices are really nice and cheap. It depends upon if you're a producer, or if you're a manufacturer, or if you're heating your home. But if it's the latter, then they're very nice and cheap in northeastern Ohio. As these pipelines are built out, some of that will begin to even out. But that is an important distinction. Oil and gas, you know, they're coming from the same hole, different concentrations, but they are two different markets at this point. And right now, we're permitted to export natural gas, and there are facilities being built to export liquefied natural gas. But legally, we're not permitted to export at least unrefined oil at this point. If it's refined to some degree, we can export it. It'd be interesting, I think, Judd, to see what Congress does with that and how that might impact the market.
Yeah, if that happens, that might expand the exploration back up here to northeastern Ohio. So,
oh yeah, we were all excited at one point up here in northeastern Ohio. We had, 4 years ago, we had people knocking on our doors with leases and asking us to review leases. But as Judd says, it really has moved. It's moved south, and I think we'll continue to be down there for a while. But I tell people that I think it will happen in northeastern Ohio at some point as the technology gets better. But it's not going to happen imminently.
Given the fact that there's a pretty large supply of natural gas down there, what challenges are facing sort of the Utica region currently on trying to maximize, you know, the export of this abundance of natural gas in that area?
Development of the infrastructure, I would say, is the first issue, Mike. I mean, there are large quantities of this gas being found, and there have to be cracker facilities built, permitting, construction time and expense, pipelines that have to be constructed to deliver the resources and infrastructure that largely wasn't in place because 10 years ago nobody was expecting this to happen. So to some extent, this time and effort and willingness to invest in these midstream assets has to come to the fore before a lot of these resources can be developed.
So is it a little chicken and the egg? I mean, is it you need to have, are commodity prices going to drive this investment, or is this investment going to take place regardless because it's the only way to really?
I think for a long time it was kind of chicken and an egg, but the midstream companies have really dedicated now tremendous resources to building pipelines. Whether we'll get a cracker facility here, I think, is still somewhat up in the air. I think people feel pretty optimistic.
And here is?
In Ohio, essentially,
okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it would be nice because that really permits us then to be taking these natural gas liquids out of the methane and using them for everything from propane to ethane to a variety of products that can be used in manufacturing. But it's been kind of interesting representing some of these midstream companies. People out there, you know, it used to be that pipeline company come along in southeastern Ohio, for example, and pay someone some bare minimum amount to go across their property. But these folks understand what the value of these pipelines are right now, and we're seeing, you know, whereas you might have gotten away with $10 or $15 per lineal foot, you know, we're seeing $50, $60, $85 in certain cases, sometimes even higher. For pipeline rights that exist on paper but may arguably have been abandoned over time, that's a big issue. You know, if you have a pipeline right which was there since the late 1890s or early 1900s, which we've seen in some cases, can the midstream company, the pipeline company, put a new pipeline within that area? We've seen certainly that some of these blanket easements where the farmer's whole property is under easement have not been enforced and have really been limited to where the prior pipeline occurred. And things like this, again, have negative impacts on oil and gas companies because it makes, if the midstream is more expensive, then that's a higher amount that the E&P companies have to pay to get the midstream transported. It's been interesting. It's been fascinating, actually.
Absolutely.
Well, turning sort of to some of the ancillary industries in the oil field service industries that help, you know, supply the E&Ps and others, obviously there's been significant CapEx cuts by the E&P companies with respect to the oil field service companies. You read upwards of 40%. You know, what other steps are happening in that particular industry? Steve, I don't know if you have some thoughts on some of those issues. I mean, it's a very fragmented industry, you know, all these suppliers. What do you see someone being able to pick up that, you know, that lost volume? Is it going to come from somewhere else?
I mean, it's too early to tell exactly what's going to happen in this industry, but I think you can take a cue from other industries where you've had similar things. Typically what happens is the smaller or the more leveraged entities are sooner or later going to have to realize, or their lenders or their other constituents will force them to realize that you know, they can't continue to go it alone. And I think it's going to be a very good opportunity if your clients are in the space, they have dry powder and the ability to sit and wait. Because I think there's going to be recognizing this is cyclical and it is going to come back in a big way to take advantage, and it's going to be basically a buyer's market. You know, on the other hand, if you're one of the smaller players in the space, you need to really consider your options, because in terms of maximizing value to, you know, your shareholders, your creditors, it's sometimes difficult to do so, but sometimes you have to make a decision. We're better off selling now than trying to hold out, because, you know, when it's going to come back is still anybody's guess.
And I guess the flip side is that some people are hesitant because they're not sure when where the bottom is, right? You know, people want to buy at the lowest possible price.
True. You know, and some people may want to sit and you know, wait it out even a little bit longer before they start pulling the triggers on acquiring things, although from what I'm seeing, and I'm not the industry specialist that you guys are, but prices are inching up. The industry seems to be very resilient. People seem to be able to make money at lower prices than people originally projected. So, you know, I don't know that I would wait much longer.
In terms of, you know, others that rely on, you know, the other industries like steel and automotive, I mean, there's obviously been a lot of impact and newspaper reports about what's going on there. I mean, how tied together would you say, you know, at least as of now, what's happening with oil and gas and the steel industry, for example?
Well, it's weird. There's a correlation between steel prices and oil prices. There always has been. I've heard it explained a number of ways. Obviously, one way is that a significant portion of the steel that's produced, at least in this country, is used in the oil and gas industry. Obviously, as exploration and the oil market has slowed down, that's impacted steel prices. But candidly, what's really driving the decline in the steel industry is the flooding of the market from China and Korea and other sources. I mean, that's a much stronger driver of what's causing the depressed steel prices right now.
I mean, think about 3 miles of pipes for one well. You know, you're going to go down a mile vertically and a couple miles horizontally. That's a tremendous amount of production for a steel plant. And certainly there have been some pretty tremendous, significant layoffs in the Lorain plant, for example, that was producing a lot of tubular steel for the wells. So all these industries play back and forth. And just in terms of the U.S. economy, too, an Ohio economy, these lower oil and gas prices were, in the old days, you may think, that would have been great, right? We would have loved it if oil and gas was cheaper. Mm-hmm. It's definitely a two-edged sword today, because an awful lot of people have been laid off because of that.
And what's interesting, if you look at another tangential industry, automotive, with lower gas prices, car sales have not gone up.
Yeah.
What you've seen is a change in what cars are purchased. There's more trucks, more sales of larger vehicles, which actually hurts the domestic auto producers because they're required to produce a lot of energy efficient vehicles to meet the CAFE standards, which they're not able to sell right now. So, you know, they're running behind in producing trucks, can't make them fast enough, and they've got the smaller vehicles that the government mandates sitting on the lot.
Yeah. I would add there's a a subset of the shale play, the Marcellus industry that's impacted by the shale play, and that's your traditional oil and gas producers in the state of Ohio, the smaller producers that are the quintessential producers that helped start the industry here in Ohio, that don't have the wherewithal to get involved in the shale play, but in fact probably traded a lot of their leases or assigned a lot of their leases to the large E&P companies that gave them a pool of money to go back and do traditional oil and gas exploration. In other areas in Ohio, with that pool of money that I think is going to be a second wave of the oil and gas boom here in Ohio, that I don't think a lot of people, including our accountant friends, are spending a lot of time paying attention to, but that I think is very important.
Yeah, it has been interesting, the number of smaller companies that have actually, as you say, obtained their funds from the sale of certain lease rights to the big boys and have come back and said, hey, we can do this too, you know, and you can, they go out and they know who the suppliers are for the sand, for the lights, for the pipe, and for the rigs, and all they need is some money and they're in business to do it, but they're often heavily leveraged as well. So I think this, whereas some of the bigger companies are going to be more likely to weather lower prices, some of the smaller companies really need this price of natural gas in particular, if we're talking the Utica and the Marcellus, this price of natural gas to come up a little bit for them.
And Judd, what's the stat? It's 95% of all independent producers have 12 employees on average, so they're truly ma and pa, for lack of a better term.
Yeah, that's about right, Mike. And that's, you know, the kind of people that have traditionally, companies have developed the oil and gas in the state of Ohio. And what we found is with new technologies unrelated to shale, 3D seismic, for example, they can go back to the traditional areas, Morrow County, Ohio, Muskingum County, down through Athens County, even up in the northeastern part of the state, and go beyond the shallow Clinton formations that were the traditional bread and butter of those companies, to find deeper Rose Run or Beekmantown formations that truly are outstanding wells and produce a lot of minerals. And I think you're going to see a lot of that development, assuming that we can keep, you know, intangible drilling costs as a deduction and other things that drive that industry. I know that's a topic for a moment.
But. Well, I mean, let's just talk about it now. And that was actually one of the questions that someone sent in prior to the presentation. As in President Obama's proposed 2016 budget, there was the president or his staff removed the tax deduction for intangible drilling costs. You know, and the question was whether or not that there's actually going to be any, you know, legitimate chance that that's going to ultimately make it as part of Congress's budget. McDonnell Hopkins is an affiliated entity called McDonnell Hopkins Government Services, and we've spoken to the folks there, and they've talked to the folks on the Hill, and given where the industry is right now and where the Republicans are in Congress, you know, there's obviously a lot of things that are proposed as part of, you know, wants in the president's proposed budget. This is not one of those things that likely is going to make it into any final budget. And I think they've tried in the past to remove this deduction, and it's at this point in time that there's very little risk that that's going to ultimately become law.
Yeah, and you wonder if that isn't the reason it was in the president's budget, knowing full well that
just
it wasn't going to pass.
Just a giveaway, right?
Because when you look at the administration's plan for energy in the United States, it relies very, very heavily on shale gas. And, you know, our production is up 80% for natural gas than what it was in 2006 or so, and it's been an amazing economic benefit to the country. And to try to tax this in a way that will lose more jobs, that will cut back on the industry, has to be ultimately counterproductive. So I can't imagine they were serious about it, but I'm sure there was a certain segment that liked to see that in there, and so they were satisfying that segment.
And actually, just staying on sort of the tax issue, but moving it on a more local level. I mean, the severance tax in Ohio has obviously made a lot of news with the governor's proposal versus what the state legislature would be promoting. You know, what's the nature of the tax, and why is it such a hot button issue right now?
Yeah. You want to take that, Cheddar?
No, you go ahead.
Okay. You know, oil and gas drilling in Ohio for a long time has been kind of a mom and pop operation. And the severance tax was really quite low, and is today quite low in comparison to other states. So I think Governor Kasich saw an opportunity to increase that tax and to pass that benefit on to income tax payers in the state, which would then help reduce Ohio's income tax rate, which is higher than average and is a real negative for the state. There are certain people who would like to use that severance tax benefit, if it's ever passed, for more local projects, and maybe some combination of that occurring in the future. But as you say, the Ohio House and Senate have not, Republican controlled in each case, have really disagreed with that. Now, what we understand, and very just recently, again, through our Ohio government connections, is that the Senate Republicans and the House Republicans are going to meet, and in the next 3 months, try to come up with a plan for a severance tax, which is probably someplace middle of the road in terms of the country in comparison with surrounding states and also with western states. And so that's likely to happen. Will that have a negative impact on the industry? I think you'd have to say that any tax to some degree has a negative impact, although I think the general understanding is so long as the tax is competitive with other states and so long as it doesn't get too far out of control, it probably will not have a major impact, at least on oil and gas drilling in the state.
It doesn't seem to me to be necessarily the most reliable. I mean, you have to have a pretty conservative estimate because the production fluctuation and the price fluctuation, I mean, you can't just assume every year you're going to have sort of this, you know, fixed amount of revenue coming in based on this tax.
Yeah, especially in today's world when you're not sure what the pricing is going to be.
Right.
Yeah.
And going back to the mom-and-pop producers, I mean, the severance tax proposed increase, I think, is largely born out of the notion that the shale boom here provides a vast pool of resources to defer taxes on the citizens by virtue of a severance tax. But the economics of your traditional oil and gas wells, the non-shale wells, really can't bear the burden of an additional severance tax.
Yeah. Under Kasich's proposal, there were going to be two tiers. I'm not sure what they'll ultimately come up with, but under Kasich's proposal, just the pure vertical wells were going to have a separate rate in comparison to the horizontal wells.
Well, sort of the tension between, you know, between the government and the citizens. I mean, going to another issue that was recently decided by the Ohio Supreme Court, the issue of whether state or local, if the state preempts sort of local ordinance and home rule in the Morrison v. Beck Energy case. Judd, I think you have some experience in those particular issues specifically.
That issue, whether municipalities can go in and regulate and to what extent they can regulate oil and gas production that's permitted otherwise by the state of Ohio under the revised code, has been litigated for many, many years before that decision. And traditionally, preemption has been found in that municipalities don't have the ability to prohibit or regulate that which the state permits and otherwise regulates. And this new case, I think, just re-emphasizes that in the context of Ohio's home rule, which I think is good in that it provides certainty to those people valuing reserves on balance sheets to understand, that the uncertainty of having reserves in an area that might otherwise be within a municipality cannot be affected by local zoning and ordinances. Now, as Jeff pointed out, there was a concurring opinion in this where one of the justices expressed a willingness to allow some form of reasonable regulation, not to the point of exclusion, but that's an open issue. And as we sit here today, local municipalities, even under their home rule powers, cannot prevent or otherwise regulate what was otherwise permitted under Ohio revised code.
Although there are some localities that prohibit, you know, oil and gas drilling in their communities.
Yellow Springs, and again, thankfully, there's no oil and gas over there for them to regulate. So
that's what we've seen. It's those places that don't actually have it that want to regulate it. But yeah, this whole idea of state regulation versus local regulation has been a big deal in Pennsylvania too. And in Pennsylvania, they have some higher level of permissible level of local regulation. But as Jed was saying, there's that middle justice there. The fourth justice in the majority, who wrote a separate opinion from the majority, that left a lot of room open for local zoning restrictions, so long as they're reasonable, so long as they're tied to traditional zoning. And what really killed the case in the Beck Energy case for the municipality there was that they had a conditional use permit, which was required in order to drill, and the court looked at that and said, wait a second, the state's in charge of permitting for oil and gas, not the municipality, so we're not going to let you get away with a conditional use permit. But boy, there was a lot of room left open potentially for zoning, so that middle person could join with the three on the other side, and it'll be very interesting.
Stay tuned,
exactly, yeah.
Well, when the Utica came online in 2010, I guess was sort of the early, you know, we heard about it, and then folks like Chesapeake came in and just started buying massive leasehold positions, and then others followed suit, and there's been a lot of turnover and transfer those leases, and who the players are, you know, in 2015 are different than those years. But some of those initial leases are, you know, they're typically for 5-year terms, and some of the production may not be happening yet. I mean, Judd, what do you see as being some of the issues that folks are going to face coming up?
There are, and again, I keep coming back because we're talking to a group of accountants. Mm-hmm. How do we value the resources that we have as an asset on our balance sheets? Now, how do we not only quantify the price, but the amount that we have as against that pricing? And lease issues have a large factor in there in terms of the quantity that we have. And we have lease expiration. So say, for example, a Chesapeake or a Gulfport acquired 24,000 acres of leases from one of the mom and pop corporations that we just talked about. And those leases had a provision in it, for example, that said this lease automatically extends for 5 years unless and until such and such happens. And an attorney brings suit on behalf of one landowner that says that provision doesn't apply. And those issues are being litigated all the time, and the next thing you know, you've got 24,000 acres of leasehold interest that are in jeopardy that you don't know, do I own these mineral interests or not? And there are all kinds of typical traditional lease provisions that are impacted, such as, you know, paying in commercially reasonable quantities. How much have I had to produce, and have I been doing that? And did my lease really expire 10 years ago? There are held by production issues that we just talked about. So there are, you know, with a lot of these older leases, issues that were never contemplated that come to the fore now because of the value of these leases. And believe me, there are attorneys all over the state of Ohio that are looking to get their landowners out of these leases and into new ones so that they can get their $5,000, $6,000, $7,000 an acre upfront payment that they otherwise wouldn't have. So there's a lot of incentive to challenge these leases. There are a lot of open issues as it relates to these leases, and those open issues completely affect the valuation of the reserves that are being held by any particular company.
Because there's going to be a lot more non-producing acreage?
From an accounting standpoint, how do I book?
It's uncertainty. It's uncertainty. They're just, you can't, and accountants, we know, do not like uncertainty.
And so this also, so something else that was recently litigated at the Ohio Supreme Court level was the Dormant Mineral Act. I think the issues that came up sort of in those multiple cases that yet to be determined also play into this same concern in terms of uncertainty.
And Jeff was very much involved in some of that litigation, but again, it's the uncertainty, and people are very much, why is it all of a sudden now we're, you know, after 20 or 30 or 40 years of the Ohio Dormant Mineral Act, are we now litigating this? It's because there's value to it, which creates the uncertainty. And I know, Jeff, you were very much involved in the recent Ohio Supreme Court case.
Yeah, it's as you say, it's a statute it's two versions of the statute now, and passed without much fanfare. There wasn't a whole lot of economic activity surrounding it, but a lot of people are surprised to learn that under the DMA, the Dormant Mineral Act, if you're the owner of minerals, you could lose those minerals to the surface right owner. Okay. Just under the old act, under the 89 Act, automatically, under the current act, there's some notice that's required to the holder of the mineral rights. But this has raised, and don't have time to get into them today, this has raised a tremendous number of issues and has put a lot of title issues out there for the oil and gas companies where, you know, if they have, they're trying to put together a 700-acre tract, a 700-acre unit, and they find that maybe a third of their properties have mineral right, Dormant Mineral Act issues. Do we pay who appears to own the mineral rights under the most recent deed, or have those rights, in fact, now gone to the surface owner? You know, in some cases, we're finding that these E&P companies are actually paying both because they want to get going on the unit. So, you know, maybe you own it, maybe you own it, we're going to pay both of you. And that's what they're forced to do. The Supreme Court has heard a lot of these issues, a lot of these cases, and our thought is they'll probably decide them all pretty much together. I think in the beginning, the Supreme Court didn't really quite get it, but now they do, and it looks like they're doing a pretty good job, and we would hope to have some, maybe not finality, but a whole lot of assistance on these issues within probably the next few months at this point.
Well, sort of staying on the regulatory, the EPA in the last couple weeks came out with a report that said that, you know, there's no impact on, fracking doesn't have a materially bad impact on water supply. The EPA report didn't talk about air quality, it didn't talk about earthquakes, it didn't talk about a lot of things. What do you foresee, at least in our area, to be some of the hot button environmental issues? I mean, maybe even though the water's clean, there might be other issues involving water and use of it. What do you see is going to be a 2015, 2016 issue?
I know that I just read in the Wall Street Journal today that there's another report out that, yes, the water isn't impacted necessarily by fracking, but the amount of water available through regular water wells could be at issue. I mean, it takes millions of gallons of water to frack one of these wells. And what we're seeing is debate on two front, who has a right to access that water. As we talked about before, who would have thought water would be more valuable than oil and gas in the shale play, but it truly is more of a limited resource and necessary resource. So we're seeing a lot of litigation and issues over who has right to access and under what circumstances. And we are seeing some groups that, irrespective of recent findings, are challenging the legitimacy of fracking under the context of being a pollution and a harm to the environment, a public nuisance. So those issues are out there, and I know, Jeff, you've got an article.
Yeah, I mean, you've got 1,400, 1,600 wells, and some of them are going to fail. And the perception out there in the public sometimes has been that fracking is inherently an activity which is going to cause water problems. And the EPA, the EPA is... EPA is the EPA, right? they came out with I think a good, well-balanced study of what was going on, and they determined that as an industry in general, fracking is not an issue. Now, does that mean that you won't potentially have problems with water contamination? Well, of course not. If the casing is done improperly as you're going through an aquifer, that's a problem that can lead to contamination, but that's been true since 1870.
Right, that's a negligence issue. Right?
That's right. There's nothing new. It's negligence issue. It's poor practices. That there's nothing new about that. But there's nothing inherent in fracking. What is fracking? It's basically going into these tight shale formations and pumping water, pumping sand, proppants to open up these fractures to let the hydrocarbons out. There's nothing inherently dangerous about that. If you spill some fracking fluid on the ground, that's a problem. If you spill some into a river, that's a problem. But these are issues which are perhaps larger than they had been before, but only because the industry is larger. That's an important thing to remember. And I think, ironically, I think air pollution was probably a bigger issue when you really step back and look at it. And under the green recapture rules, which are coming more and more into effect and really even beginning this year, these oil and gas companies are required to capture the methane which is coming off of these well apparatus. And it's because methane is a greenhouse gas and probably 10 times worse than carbon monoxide.
Well, it's as you know, oil prices declined, you know, everybody kept reading in the news that there's going to be a rash of bankruptcies, and there's been some, usually in the more expensive offshore. There's been some Canadian companies that it's just very expensive for them to drill that have gone into some sort of insolvency proceeding up there. But overall, there hasn't been the rash of bankruptcy filings, certainly in the E&P space, that everyone thought was likely to happen. What are some reasons, Steve? I don't know if you have any thoughts on, you know, what could this be attributed to? Why did, you know, the sky is falling, but it didn't really fall as much as we anticipated, at least as of today?
Well, I think there's several factors at play. You know, as we noted earlier, you know, I'm not one ever to underestimate the resiliency of businessmen or entrepreneurs. I mean, it seems, you know, throughout our history, you know, a whole bunch of different industries, when times get tough, people adapt. And especially when you look at a fragmented industry that's run by, as you guys call them, mom-and-pop shops, those guys, in my experience, by and large, seem to be pretty adept at adapting to change. So, you know, they've managed to get more efficient, make money or cash flow or cut production or do what they need, you know, to really avoid hitting the wall, as it were. Secondly, if you look at the lenders, who are usually the first ones that kind of force bankruptcies, not always the case, but in a lot of cases, a lot of instances, that's the case. If you look at what motivates them, you know, they read the same information we do. They realize this is cyclical. Secondly, what are their options? I mean, the value of a company's reserves, which impact their liquidity, may be lowered, but lowering a company's liquidity really doesn't help the bank, because all that means is that they're going to run out of money or they can't pay their expenses, which means the bank ultimately has to foreclose. And what's it foreclosing on? It's foreclosing on a bunch of rights that are at their lowest ebb, which means the bank isn't going to get out and things are going to be sold. So I think what you're going to see here is what you've seen in a lot of industries. What's happening in the steel industry right now is very, I think, maybe a good example. In the steel industry, values are way down. Instead of forcing borrowers to write down their inventory, or even if they do have to write it down for regulatory or accounting requirements, the banks turn around and give them an over advance. Now, it doesn't mean that there's not some pain associated with that, because they may go in and say, we want cost cuts, you have to hire a financial advisor, we're going to strengthen our covenants, maybe whack you with a higher interest rate. But by and large, the banks are doing what they've done in a lot of instances over time, which is extend and pretend and, you know, just kick the can down the road, because it's better than recognizing a loss. I mean, if you're an accountant and you have a client that's facing this issue, you know, my suggestion would be to get to the bank and explain to them calmly, without table pounding, what their alternatives are. Because candidly, you know, once you've instituted the cost cuts so that you're not burning cash or using their collateral, which tends to irritate banks, what are their other options? They don't want to have your clients shut down, because their recovery is going to be lower, and they then have to, once they have to start reserving against, you know, your client's loan as a potential write-off, then they have to go through regulatory and reporting requirements, which they don't want to do. So it's, I think, not that difficult in most cases or situations like this to get the bank to write it out with you.
I would add to that, Steve. I think a lot of the the leases here. First of all, I don't think the banks want to be in the business of exploring for minerals. But a lot of the leases have provisions in them that if there's an assignment for the benefit of creditors, a bankruptcy, that the leases all terminate. It's void, and I know that might be addressed in the bankruptcy proceeding, but there's additional risk to the bank about even losing the interest that they have.
Well, you raised two good points there. First of all, typically an ipso facto clause that says it's void on bankruptcy is not enforceable, but bankruptcy has other impacts on leases because in a lot of these cases, what you think is a lease is not a lease. It may be a real property interest. What you think is a real property interest may be a disguised financing arrangement because, you know, the way they fragment and allocate the right to pull minerals out of the ground and who's doing what and what the interest looks like and is it perfected gets to be very complicated, which, you know, if I'm a lender and that's my collateral, I've got to be very concerned before I go into a forum where the key thing everybody does in a Chapter 11 is drill down on whether or not the bank's covered. And that's the one thing you don't want to expose yourself to. So I think that has a lot to do with it too.
Well, another question that we received prior to the webinar was, you know, should we expect to see major year-end downward reserve revisions or simply financial impairments? I think it's largely speculative at this point, given the uncertainty as to which way the commodity prices are going to go. I don't know if anyone else has a thought on.
That sounds like an accounting question.
Right, exactly. Of course it is.
We should be asking these guys.
Yeah.
But you know, I think the experience that we're seeing is that it's E&P companies to this point, what they've been able to do is really get some pretty dramatic cost cuts from their suppliers. And it's the suppliers that, to this point, are bearing, I think, most of the burden of the lower prices. So if your business is supplying sand, your business is supplying a particular kind of fracking fluid, and you have four or five competitors all willing to reduce their prices down, it's you know, it can be pretty tough. So if we're likely to see issues with companies going out of business or being purchased by stronger companies, it's probably most likely to occur at that supplier level. Something else that we're seeing, though, is if you're a supplier who can make your E&P company more efficient, if you have a new way and better way for recycling water, for example, that's something we didn't touch on to a great degree. Recycling of water is a huge deal right now. These companies would like to recycle all of their water, mm-hmm. and they're actually getting fairly close to it. So the amount of water they're pulling out of wells is not nearly as high as it used to be. But if you can make your E&P company more efficient, then suddenly you have some real added value there. If you can distinguish yourself, that's what you need to do in this industry. And from what everyone's been saying here too, the great thing about American industry is that there's a track record for doing that, whether it be the mom-and-pa company or a particular division of a larger company. That competitive spirit is really strong. And that's one thing that the Saudis have seen. They've been really surprised at the ability of the U.S. oil and gas industry to continue to make money at substantially lower prices.
And just one thing, if your client is a supplier to the E&Ps, there are still some things you can do to try to protect them in case things go awry suddenly. Mm-hmm. You know, depending on the state that you're in, there's a lot of material mend liens, depending on what it is you're providing. In some states, like Texas, you get that if you're a supplier, you get a lot of those lien rights automatically. Ohio is not like that, but it does have mechanics and material mends liens that you can perfect. It's a little bit tricky depending on where and what your client is providing, but you can get them a lien right. In a lot of cases, if you do that correctly, you prime their existing bank. That's one thing. The other thing is that on the Uniform Commercial Code, that if you have reason to believe that the buyer is not going to be able to pay you, you can send a demand for adequate assurance, and they have to give you some reasonable assurance that they're going to pay or otherwise comply, or you can suspend performance. It doesn't mean you can get paid for what you're already out, but at least you can stop, and they can't force you to continue to supply them. So if you have a long-term sand contract or service contract, you can at least get out of it.
Mm-hmm. I think those are good points, Steve. And one thing I would advise, at least our Ohio contingent, is to be thinking about their lien rights before they start service and not running into a problem and then trying to go back and create the lien. There are certain things that have to be done as soon as work begins or materials are supplied, even when there's not a problem, to give rise to those lien rights.
Yeah, no, and what I would urge people to do is you can develop a checklist for the client so that they know, I'm about to sign a contract, I got to send a notice of furnishing. I'm about to provide material, I have to give a notice to this party or that party, so that they have a roadmap and it becomes rote almost for them to do that. And it's very similar in construction industries, tooling industries, other industries that have these same issues, where once people get used to it, they do it as a matter of course, so that by and large, when something goes sideways, they can enforce their lien rights.
Taking it a step further, I mean, if the company that someone's dealing with ultimately, says, I need to file bankruptcy. I mean, generally speaking, I mean, there's a lot of, bankruptcy sometimes has a negative attached with it, but there's actually a lot of good reasons sometimes to file bankruptcy. Not the least of it would be the automatic stay of collection efforts. I mean, what other things do you see? I mean, is a last resort. What do you foresee as the biggest benefits to you?
Well, it really depends, like it always does, on what the company is facing. But a lot of times there are benefits to actually filing a Chapter 11. Obviously the automatic stay, which would stop the hordes of creditors from reaching in to reclaim material that's subject to liens. You can't force a bank to advance, but a lot of banks are much more willing to advance in a Chapter 11 because they can get a post-petition financing order that ensures that at least to the extent they're putting money in it afterwards, it's a valid, perfected, super priority or first priority lien over everything else. It also, I think, in this industry gives you the ability to sell. Because the best way, the best title you can get, I once had a bankruptcy judge, tell me, the only one that can give better title than me is God. And that's because Section 363 of the Bankruptcy Code enables a debtor to sell assets free and clear of all liens and interests, which is pretty powerful. There's some exceptions to that, but a Chapter 11 really gives a nice forum to go through what is the bundle of rights that the debtor has to address all the challenges and then sell it. Also, a lot of the licenses are executory contracts, which means if the borrower has the ability to get rid of this one and resell or relicense this asset or stream of materials coming out at a higher price, it can do so. And it depends a lot on state law, because in a lot of states, a mineral license is deemed to be a real property interest and it's not part of the bankruptcy estate. That's not the case in Ohio. It really depends. In Pennsylvania, it's an executory contract until they actually extract minerals, and then it becomes a real property interest. So it really depends, but it's complicated, but in a lot of instances, if you're at that point, it may be the best way to maximize value, whether it's by a sale or getting rid of the under-market lease rights that you have and being able to get a better value for them.
Yeah, and I guess depending on one's perspective, the case law in Ohio in bankruptcy is not terribly well developed on these issues because a lot of folks, while the industry's been around for a long time in Ohio, the shale industry is relatively new and a lot of these issues get litigated outside of the Ohio forum, so there's not a lot of case law yet on these. But based on the potential growth, I suspect that over the coming years, judges here are going to have to start facing the same issues that the Texas and Oklahoma and Louisiana judges are seeing.
And that's just true for oil and gas law as well in the state of Ohio. In comparison to Pennsylvania or some other neighboring states, certainly in comparison to Texas, Oklahoma, Colorado, the law here has quite a bit of development to do, if you will.
Do you think that's going to be, is it a lot of going to be driven statutory? Are we going to see a lot of new laws pop up, or do you think most of it's going to be?
It's a combination between between stuff coming out of the legislature and just basic common law. You know, what are some of the implied obligations in a lease for the lessee to be developing the property? You walk into Pennsylvania and find out that pretty quickly. In the state of Ohio, there's an awful lot that's still up in the air.
And I think, you know, in terms of certainty, again, for the accountants, one of the big issues here under that analysis is what kind of costs are associated or can be deducted from the royalties that I have to pay my, mm-hmm. my landowner for producing these minerals. I mean, typically it was an eighth royalty. We've seen them up, you know, to almost 30% in the shale play. But the issues are what expenses can I deduct? May I deduct from those payments before I have to pay the landowner? And one of the largest of those expenses are transportation costs for getting the gas through the pipeline and the line loss of the gas through the pipeline. And there has been a tremendous amount of litigation and class action suits on that issue in Oklahoma, Texas, and in other states with differing conclusions. And that's an issue that hasn't come to the fore here yet in Ohio, but again, stay tuned because that will affect the value of everyone's minerals.
Yeah, that's become a huge topic right now between landowners and E&P companies, this difference between a gross and a net lease. What are you actually deducting out of the royalty amount?
Right.
And especially with some of these increased costs and lower values that they have for the oil and gas that's being produced, suddenly landowners who are getting real big fat checks, I mean, I'm talking 10, 20, 30, 50, 100,000 bucks a month, you know, out of some of these royalty amounts are seeing those reduced dramatically. And talking about bankruptcy, you know, they've gone out and bought these boats and these combines and everything else, and, you know, suddenly it's not. Of course, they haven't paid tax on any of this either yet so far. But it's been a rude awakening for them, too.
Well, I think, you know, the whole cheap versus expensive gas is, you know, produces a pretty tough paradox. I mean, when gas is cheap or oil's cheap, it doesn't really lead people to sort of invest in the industry. When it's expensive, it crushes sort of the growth of economies. Where do you see, you know, I mean, we talked earlier, Jeff, that, you know, the world is still lit generally by coal. But yeah. but that's not based on, you know, even global warming skeptics would probably say, you know, there are much better ways to, you know, power the earth and cleaner ways to do it. So I think that, you know, over the next 10, 20, 30 years, I mean, what do you see, at least as of now in the technologies that we know, where do you see things headed?
Yeah, I think much of the environmental, and I consider myself an environmentalist, I think much of the environmental movement really missed the mark on this because burning methane natural gas is so much cleaner than burning coal. That doesn't mean it doesn't have a negative impact on some of these areas. Luckily, some of these places like Kentucky, West Virginia also happen to have a fair amount of oil and gas as well. But I think the answer to this, and there was a Harvard economist, a Harvard Business School, who just came out, he and some others came out with an article on this, a really well thought out article. And what they're saying is that, first of all, look at what's happened with this industry. It's made a tremendously positive impact on the country economically. The people who have jobs in this industry get paid on average twice as much as your average person. It's had a great impact on the country, in particular in places like Ohio. Does it have some environmental risks? Yes, it does, but he believes that they're manageable. And if you're talking about renewables, there's no way that renewables today can supply that base load that's needed to run your air conditioning you know, when the sun isn't shining or the wind isn't blowing. But, you know, I think, frankly, we will get to the point someday where renewables are probably supplying a majority of our energy costs. So how do you get there? And their conclusion is that the best way to get there until 2030, 2040, some time period like that, is natural gas, frankly. That's the cleanest to burn. It's gonna permit us to reduce emissions. And in places like China and India that are relying so heavily on coal right now, to the extent that they can get more heavily into natural gas, that's going to have all kinds of improvements. So to try to knock down the natural gas oil industry today is completely counterproductive. It's not to say that there aren't issues. Sure, here and there are issues. It's an industrial activity, but it's a great bridgeway into the future energy needs of the country, in my opinion, at least.
And it appears to me that Utica, I mean, if we could, you know, bridge the highs and lows of the market, this we're set up if the right things happen, both at the government level and the investment level, that this could be a very strong.
It should be a win-win. And yeah. I think ODNR is doing a good job on this, protecting the resources. Jed, your thoughts on this too. It has, I think, had a tremendous benefit to the state.
No, I think the Ohio Oil and Gas Association and Department of Natural Resources have really worked together in a responsible way to do this exploration in a very constructive manner. I read somewhere yesterday that between Ohio and Pennsylvania there are over 300 years of petroleum reserves left for production. So it's going to be here. And I think you're going to see the cyclicality of the production or not based on traditional economic drivers that drive all
supply and demand,
all business. Yeah.
Well, we promise to conclude this as close as possible to 1 p.m. Eastern time. It is that time. If you have additional questions, please feel free to email them to us, and we will certainly get back to you. We're going to continue to follow all of the goings on in the oil and gas industry. Another way to communicate with us is through our online community, which is the Business Advocate. It's at businessadvocate.mcdonaldhopkins.com. The URL is on the front page of your handout. Please tune in for follow-up information. We look forward to hearing about your thoughts and perspectives on this matter, and we really appreciate your time today. Thank you very much.